multiverse. Every existence multiplied by possibility and spread out in infinite measure. Now there is a malevolent force at work, one driven by a singular goal, the destruction of all there is.
Hi everyone, this is Scott with The Art of Planning, and in this video, I'm doing something a little different than I've done in past videos. This video isn't going to spotlight the Art of Planning planner.
One thing is certain. Everything we know, everything there is, and everything there ever was, is doomed.
We still offer it, still available, the link will be in the description, but that's not the purpose of this video. Instead, I want to talk about a recent interview I read in IndieWire Magazine that has a lot to say about project management, goal setting within a tight timeline, and collaboration among different teams.
Right, so we are going to need a bigger team.
The Art of Planning has always been about more than selling our planner. Our mission is to get you thinking about planning as an art, as a practice. And I thought this was a great example of planning in the real world. The interview is with writer and TV producer Marc Guggenheim. The interview centers on his involvement in the television adaptation of Crisis on Infinite Earths, or Crisis for short, which started airing on the CW network the week of December 8th, 2019, and will conclude in January of 2020. So what's Crisis? Crisis is a DC comic story from the 80s, and it's a huge story. I'll offer some links in the description if you want to know more about the comic book series, but it's enough for the purposes of this video to know that it's one of the most expansive stories in comic book history, and really one of the most ambitious. Nearly every DC character is involved, and Guggenheim is the person in charge of adapting this craziness into a 5-hour, family-friendly TV movie on a TV movie budget. That probably already sounds like a huge undertaking, but something that makes it even trickier is that each hour of this 5-hour movie is written, filmed, and directed by a different creative team, because each hour is actually an episode of a separate TV series. A little bit of background. The CW has a handful of DC superhero shows going on right now. Supergirl, Batwoman, Flash, Arrow, Black Lightning, and Legends of Tomorrow. I think that's all of them. And often characters from one series cross over onto another one, or they're referenced on another show or something, to the point that all these shows can be thought of as existing in the same universe. People have settled on calling this the Arrowverse. I don't know who started that, but it's pretty standard now. Because Arrow, Green Arrow if you know the comic book character, is the longest running of these shows. Now, not only do these shows all exist in the same universe, the Arrowverse, but once a year or so, there's some kind of multi-episode team-up where characters from two or more shows band together to fight some catastrophe, aliens or Nazis or something. And these story arcs hop from one series to another. For example, a two-part crossover story involving the Flash and Arrow might start with part one as a Flash episode, then conclude with part two as an Arrow episode the next night. Well, Crisis is set up just like that, only it's a five-parter that's playing out over episodes of Supergirl, Batwoman, Flash, Arrow, and Legends of Tomorrow. Each of these creative teams have their own interests that they need to consider. Each director has a different aesthetic, each show's writers have to keep in mind everything that's happening, plot and character-wise in their respective series, and Crisis can't ignore that stuff, but Crisis has to make sense and be engaging as a cohesive 5-hour story. Now, I'm not saying you should care about the Crisis story, or any of these shows, or the CW, or me, but I'm just laying out how the Arrowverse works to explain why you have this sort of relay race situation where the batons are being passed from one creative team to another in this whole Crisis story arc. And that's just the artistic difficulty of doing something this ambitious. Pulling off Crisis is also tricky because the whole thing, all the different episodes with all the creative teams, all needed to be filmed within a month and all at the same time. Not literally at the same time, but it's possible that if, for example, Supergirl scene 3 and Arrow scene 11 had a lot of the same actors, you probably had those two scenes being shot back to back. So one creative team would run in, shoot their scene, and then they'd run out, then the other creative team would come in and shoot their scene. And considering the creative and logistical feats required to make Crisis happen, it's pretty impressive that Guggenheim and everyone involved got this thing done. Whether or not you're an Arrowverse fan, just as an admirer of people who seem to be good at their job. So how did they do it? Well, I'm going to read you Guggenheim's description of the process from the article, and I'll give some commentary afterwards. So here's what Guggenheim said. Several months ago, I met with all the showrunners of the five shows, as well as a bunch of members of the various writing staffs, and I basically pitched them a potential structure for the crossover, where the main plot beats of each of the 5 hours was laid out. And my intention there was really just to create a scaffold, something that we could all discuss and work around, and something that would also be a little bit modular so that we could adapt to the creative needs of various shows, as well as swap actors in and out. And we worked for 2 weeks refining that scaffolding and coming up with a more detailed set of beats. Then we each retreated to our separate writing staffs and broke out the individual episodes scene by scene and reconvened, figured out, okay, your beat really should belong in someone else's episode. This scene in hour two really needs to happen in hour three. And this thing that's happening in hour one and hour two, they contradict each other or they duplicate each other. Figuring out those things. Once we did that, we created these beat sheets and synopses and sent them off to our various production teams so that they could start wrapping their arms around the various production challenges. And so while they were doing that up in Vancouver, we were in Burbank, in my case, sometimes in Prague and sometimes in the Maldives, writing the scripts for the five episodes. And then we started basically the normal production process. And again, like you said, the hardest part is scheduling. We actually have a very fun but very low-tech procedure for how to achieve this, which is I fly up to Vancouver and I sit in a room with the five ADs, the five assistant directors. The first assistant directors on every television show, they're the ones responsible for scheduling. And they each generate schedules for their respective shows. And their schedules are basically what we call strips. And each strip represents a scene. And each show is designated by a certain color. For example, Arrow was obviously green, Flash is red. And then we have a big board, which has been basically bifurcated into squares. So it represents a huge calendar. We basically shot this over the course of a month, and we take all those schedules and we cut the strips into literal strips, and we basically are just moving paper around that board or moving strips from one day to another on this big calendar until all the strips are up on the board. And I always say those schedules are held together by spit, baling wire, and hope. They're an incredibly fragile thing, and the process is a little bit like doing three-dimensional chess with a Rubik's Cube. And I have to say, the ADs are incredible. They think in ways that make the inside of my skull bleed. And in terms of what their profession is, they have to perform at an Olympic type of level to make it all happen. And then we start shooting, and we hope that people don't get sick like they did a couple years ago, that our weather doesn't impact us like it did, not only a couple years ago, but also this year as well. We hope that everything works and everything comes together, and long and true, it pretty much always does, knock on wood. Okay, so there's a lot there about how to manage a project effectively and what Guggenheim just said. Guggenheim first came to the table with a high-level outline that the team could use as the bones of the project. He calls it the scaffolding. He then worked with his team being the creative teams of each individual series, to flesh out the details in a way that stayed true to the scaffolding, but also met the needs of the individual shows. As the showrunner for Crisis and as the leader for this team, the key for Guggenheim had to be thinking of the final story, the final product, the final production, really, as everyone's baby, not just his. If he stubbornly held on to each and every one of his ideas, individual shows may have suffered because of it. Now, I'm sure that they all compromised here and there, but that's different from having something in the story, the Crisis story, that actually damaged the continuity or future of one of the participating series. Or maybe one of the shows just wasn't getting as much from the Crisis story in terms of interesting plot points relative to the other shows. And as the project manager, this speaks to why Guggenheim would want the ADs and creative teams to have a place at the table so they could sort of have a voice and share that if that's their point of view as the ambassadors of their respective shows during the fleshing out process. And this speaks to another point. In this scenario, a good project manager, I'm sure Guggenheim did this, a good project manager understands that the best result comes when they rely on the expertise of their team. I guarantee you that the creative teams of each respective series know more about the needs of their shows than Guggenheim does. And it's more top of mind for them too. And it's their duty to provide that expertise and that perspective. And as the project manager, it's Guggenheim's responsibility to take it, or at least seriously consider it and have a good reason not to take it. Taking an authoritarian tact when it comes to decision-making or refusing to take into account the expertise offered by his team, well, that may have damaged the final product, the different series involved, or both. And I guarantee you morale also would have suffered. And morale is so important when the timeline is tight like this, as I'm sure a lot of you have experienced in your professional lives, because everyone's working so hard. You know, emotions tend to be closer to the surface and more difficult to regulate. There may be some sleep deprivation promoting that as well. And Guggenheim touches on this in his interview, not the sleep part, but the morale part. And here's what he says. He says, "We try really hard to have a positive attitude and create a positive environment. But I have to say, we've had crossovers in years past that were a lot harder on the cast than others. And one of the things I think we've learned over the years is not just how to schedule this so that the schedule can tell the story, but to schedule in a way that doesn't abuse our cast. And I think over the last couple of years, it's been a much more positive experience for the cast and for the crew. And my philosophy is that if you walk around with your head on fire or you're constantly collapsing under the weight of all the pressure and the strain, then you're basically creating a toxic environment that filters down to everybody else. So we just try to maintain an upbeat disposition. And I do think one of the things that's helped is that this is our fifth crossover, and the fact that we've done it four times successfully already. Even though this one is far more, just we have that institutional memory. And when moments of panic threaten to set in, we're able to go, okay, you know what? We've been through bad times. We've been through challenges before. We've come through it. It's worked out before. It'll work out again now." One final note I'd like to highlight, and that's how the teams coordinated their shooting schedule with that giant calendar and the strips that represented scenes. Now this, he calls it low-tech. This admittedly low-tech method is a perfect example of something that I've learned over the years and really the reason why I started Art of Planning, one of the many. But the planning platform itself, the planning medium, should be simple. It should be as simple as it possibly can be to still get the job done. It should basically just be a framework. This allows everyone to apply their mental energy toward the planning, not trying to get their heads around the technology. In this example, he calls it three-dimensional chess. This mental energy, the work required to create a workable shooting schedule, there isn't this added hurdle, this friction of trying to comprehend this high-tech planning application. Now, there are certainly uses for technology in planning, of course. For example, after a team has done something simple like this giant board and strip technique, recording the final plan electronically for future reference, that makes perfect sense. But that's separate from the collaborative workshop that created the plan. And it helps to think of the act of planning as separate from the recording of the plan once it's been created. Planning as a practice is often best done as a low-tech process. So those are my thoughts. And if you read that article, I'm sure there are things that I didn't mention that hit home for you. And that leads me to one final point. Wherever you can, try to find real-world examples of planning in action, either in your own life by observing the planning habits of people around you, or by seeking out articles like this one. If you come across something useful, try adding it to your practice and see how it works for you. If you see or read something that you're like, I don't know about that, it goes against your planning sensibilities, explore that reaction, either in your own mind or with your peers. You might gain a new perspective, you might change your mind. At least you'll have added some rigor to your previously held beliefs if you don't change your mind. And of course, if you have any thoughts you'd like to share on this video or planning in general, you can always email me at info@artofplan or leave a comment below. Okay, that's it. Until next time, this has been Scott with The Art of Planning, and happy planning, everyone.